Okay, sure, Neeraj bhai, wait.
Okay, we are live.
Yes. Dinesh bhai?
Yeah.
Should I start?
Yes, yes, please.
Hello all. Good morning. Good morning and
recording
wishing you
in progress.
A very healthy week and a month ahead. When I was in the school, I read a chapter written by Leo Tolstoy, Little Children Wiser Than Men. So when I see my world, especially of orthopedics, I do find a significant space occupied by these young, wiser men. Yeah, of course, our kids, pediatric group of patients. So today, when even the world is preparing day and night to face the third wave of this pandemic, especially going to affect this younger group, how can we miss these little champs? So to discuss the orthopedic phase of these little champs, friends, today we have roped in senior champs. So I kindly introduce the moderators for today's session, Dr. Ashok Bhatt, a senior orthopedic surgeon practicing in Baroda since 30 plus years, and a young dynamic Dr. Kirti Ramnani, who is also a pediatric orthopedic surgeon. So I pass on the baton to Dr. Ashok Bhai and Kirti to introduce the faculties and request them to proceed. Also, just for information, this program is live on Ortho TV, and we are thankful to Dr. Neeraj and his team. Please, Dr. Ashok Bhai.
Thank you so much. I wish you all a very good morning and a warm welcome to this virtual clinical meet hosted by Baroda Orthopedic Association. And today's topic is pediatric orthopedics. Respected teachers, distinguished faculty, and dear colleagues, I would like to thank Baroda Orthopedic Association for selecting pediatric orthopedic as a topic for a meeting on a virtual platform and also giving me an opportunity to moderate this session. Dear friends, you all know that child is not a small adult. Similarly, science of pediatric orthopedics differ vastly from the general or adult orthopedics. There is a science of growing skeleton, skeletomuscular system, whether it is infection of bone, joint, or soft tissue infection, trauma, congenital anomalies, developmental delays, whether it is an infection of bone, joint, or soft tissue, trauma, congenital anomalies, developmental delays, skeletal dysplasia, various syndromic conditions, neurology, or neoplasm. The approach in clinical diagnosis, investigations, critical analysis, treatment modalities, and protocol and rehabilitation, and even final functional outcome differs principally, keeping in mind the anatomy, physiology, morphology, exponential growth disturbances. For these, a detailed knowledge of growing skeletomuscular system is mandatory for a successful outcome. Dear friends, today we have selected most common but at times a challenging injuries in pediatric orthopedics and pediatric age group of patients for updating our understanding. I hope you all enjoy this meet thoroughly and carry home useful tips to enrich yourselves. Thank you. Now I will introduce Is the screen now seen? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Visible. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So today's meet is on pediatric orthopedics. And today's program is, we have selected four topics for the management of pediatric femoral neck fractures to be presented by Dr. Ashok Vaishnavi. Pink pulseless hand in supracondylar fracture humerus by Dr. Sandeep. Physial injuries by Dr. Mandar. Missed Montegia fracture dislocation by Dr. Rajiv. And at the end, for 30 to 45 minutes, we have clinical cases which are compiled and presented by Dr. Kirti. Now, I'd like to introduce today's faculty. Dr. Ashok Vaishnavi is a consultant orthopedic surgeon, MBBS from Baroda Medical College, MS University, 1973. MS Orthopedics from MS University, Vadodara, 1977. Assistant Professor of Orthopedics, Baroda Medical College, 1978 to 1989. Professor and Head of the Department, Baroda Medical College, 1989 to 1999. Professor and Head of the Department, Corruption Medical College, 2001 to 2014. Professor at Parul Medical College, 2016 onwards. Implants Committee Member, Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India for 3 years. Secretary, Gujarat Orthopedic Association, 4 years. He is also a trustee governing body for Orthopedic Education and Research Foundation for 3 years. DNB Examiner from 1997 to 2014. And numerous ovations, guest lectures, workshops, faculty at a state level and national level for various conferences. He was also selected for 2018 summer oration by British Orthopedic Society. The next speaker is Dr. Sandeep Vaidya. He is a consultant orthopedic surgeon at Thane, Mumbai. He did his MBBS from LTM Medical College, Sion. He did his MS from GS Medical College, Mumbai in 2014. Pediatric Orthopedics Training and Senior Registrar at B.J. Wadia Hospital, Mumbai. He's a Pediatric Orthopedics Fellowship at Children's Hospital for Philadelphia, USA, National University Hospital, Singapore, and Korea University Medical College, Korea. 12 publications to his name in international peer-reviewed journals. Special interest in hip disorders and cerebral palsy. He was invited as faculty in various conferences at state and national levels. Presently the Director of Children's Orthopedic Services at Pinnacle Orthopedic Center, Thane, Mumbai. Honorary Consultant at B.J. Wadia Hospital for Children and Visiting Consultant at Jupiter Hospital, Thane, Mumbai. Dr. Mandar Agashe is a Consultant Pediatric Orthopedic Surgeon, is a Co-Director of Children's Hip Preservation Services, that is CHIPS, SRCC Children's Hospital, Mumbai. He is the Chief Consultant at Agashe Pediatric Super Speciality Clinic, Mumbai. Assistant Honorary Consultant, B.J. Wadia Hospital, Mumbai. He has done Fellowship in Pediatric Orthopedics, B.J. Wadia Hospital, Mumbai, India, and KUMC, Seoul, Korea. Redis Children Hospital, San Diego, USA. Dr. Rajiv Niravane is a Consultant Orthopedic Surgeon, Pediatric Orthopedic Specialist, Orange Healthcare PCMC, Pune and Navi Mumbai. He did his MBBS from B.J. Medical College, Pune, 2001. He did his MS Orthopedics from LTMMC, Sion, Mumbai, 2006. Extensive training in whole spectrum of pediatric orthopedics at Institute for Pediatric Orthopedic Disorders, that is IPOD in Mumbai. Special interest in deformity correction, cerebral palsy, DDH, Perthes, and other conditions. He has been a faculty at various national and international pediatric orthopedic conferences. So, dear friends, I would like to invite Dr. Ashok Vaishnavi for his first deliberation, that is femoral neck fractures in children. Dr. Vaishnavi, sir, please. Good morning.
Okay, good morning. I'm sharing screen. Ashok, you will have to stop your sharing.
Yeah. Please, sir.
Okay. Just a minute. Okay, good morning, everyone. And I'm asked to talk on pediatric fracture neck fever. So, next 15 to 20 minutes, which have been allotted to me, I will try to deliberate on this. Okay, just a minute. It is not full screen. Okay. Right. This is one of the lectures which I had delivered in one of the IRCONs in KT Dholakia CABs, and then there are certain additions to this. So this is just one of the few things which I wanted to sort of share with you. Fractures in children are of interest because not of the frequency. It is very rare fracture, but complications of these fractures are very common, and therefore it is of interest and should be of interest to everyone because we want to prevent this thing. What are the things which are peculiar for this fracture is that it is a rare fracture. Doubtful emergency, because there are persons who believe that it should be immediately reduced. There are persons who believe that there is a temporary and you should reduce the temporary effect. There are persons who don't believe it. Therefore, I am putting this as a doubtful emergency. There is a very high complication rate of this. Basically, fracture neck femur in children is a high energy trauma because there is a very thick periosteum that is an advantage. So high energy trauma gives rise to more trauma, more devastation, more injury to other structures, but thick periosteum is going to help us in some way, which we'll be seeing in the next few slides. There's a presence of physis, not one, but the two physis are very nearby to each, and there can be damage to that, and a very difficult vascularity problem. If you see the osseous anatomy of this neck, it is a very dense bone, and therefore it requires very thick or a very severe trauma to break it. Is a very small neck, and that small neck creates a problem for the persons who are going to treat it because you need to have a good fixation, you need to have a good stabilization in that small area. Sorry. Fracture cannot be impacted during the reduction. That is the problem in children, that you cannot impact it. But a good contact and stable position can only be reached with a precise reduction. So reduction is the basic sort of a point when you are treating a fractured neck. You need a good reduction. If you don't have a good reduction, it is bound to give rise to a lot many problems. Proximal femoral epiphysis and trochanteric epiphysis. These are the two physis very near. The physis separate at the age of 12 years. The trabecular pattern only appears after the age of 14 or 15. So it is not, or when you are in adult stage, you get a typical trabecular pattern. Vascularity is all known to you. I'm not going to dwell on this for long, but you know that it is a fracture which is vulnerable to injury. The advantage in the pediatric is that there is a ligamentum teres artery still intact and can supply part of the bone there. And there is a metaphyseal circulation and there are lateral epiphyseal vessels. So there are three types of circulations present, but still there can be a damage to that and will give a high rate of avascularosis. Risk of avascular necrosis after neck fracture in children is very high. There is no possibility of a compensatory blood supply available, and so we have the very bad results of that. Absence of metaphyseal drainage heightens the importance of the hemarthrosis responsible for an intracapsular pressure increase, what we call as a tamponade effect. And therefore, we should think whether an immediate surgery not possible, then whether you should release the pressure by doing an aspiration or not. The regeneration potential, that is the positive factor in this fracture neck femur, a timely intervention by internal fixation, osteotomy, pedicle bone graft, so many things are available to us, may lead to healing and normal function in instances of even a partial necrosis. So don't get worried if there is a partial necrosis. There are, if you treat them early, if you diagnose them early, and if you have a proper tools to deal with you, you may succeed in majority of the cases. Delbert's classification is one which is considered a sort of a well-accepted classification. It is followed all over. So if you see classification, I will divide it into transepiphyseal fractures with or without dislocation. Usually they correspond to the Salter-Harris type 1 or 2 up to the age of 10 years. Then there is a transcervical fracture, base of neck fracture, cervicotrochanteric fracture, and the last is the pathological fracture. Let us see individual. Type 1, transepiphyseal fracture. You can see the left side slide shows you just an epiphyseal disruption, while the right side slide type shows to a dislocation along with the epiphyseal displacement. So that becomes a more severe form of an injury. So it is usually after a major trauma. We are not talking of a slipped capital femoral epiphysis, which can occur without trauma and with, has got so many other reasons. A injury, a traumatic epiphyseal slip is always a major trauma. Prognosis is poor and catastrophic with if it is associated with the dislocation. But fortunately, this injury is rare injury. So that is an advantage to us. Non-displaced fascial injury, not very much displaced, you can do, you can just give small close reduction or you can just give a spica and manage. If it is a displaced fascial injury, in the past, usually only close reduction and spica was given. But now, we believe that reduction is the main thing, and therefore, if close reduction fails, and if you are not happy with the reduction, you should go for an open reduction. And if necessary, you may add threaded pins, canulated screws, smooth pins, or other forms of fixations. So it is necessary to have the
Sir, you are not audible, please.
Okay.
Got it, sir. Proceed, sir.
So, this is a patient, 2 months follow-up showing the physis which has been fixed with the pins. And this is the patient who, which has shown, which is an older patient, which shows that it has been fixed with the screw. So, you may add threaded pins, you may add threaded screws. The idea is to have a proper stabilization. This is another patient, 10-year-old female, injury was type 1 fracture dislocation hip and seen on the left side, was reduced, open reduction was done, and pins were attempted, and they were held by the two smooth pins. Unfortunately, post-operative film showed that this reduction was not proper, even though open reduction was done, but it was not proper, and it was still displaced and dislocated. And so it was decided that we should go and do a repeat open reduction interfixation, fixation, which was done, open reduction interfixation fixation done, fixed with screws now, a threaded pin and screws of different varieties, and it was held properly. 3 months, it was showing good results, it was holding, but there was some form of an post-traumatic ossification or an heterotopic ossification, as you see. And the 8 months, a lot of heterotopic ossification was seen, which gave rise to problems in the movements, but still it was continued, thinking that once it matures, we'll try to do something later on, but ultimately it started showing osteonecrosis. So at 11 months, the osteonecrosis was there, and which thereafter the patient was lost, so we don't have any idea what happened afterwards, but this is the last X-ray which we have. Type 2, transcervical fracture, most common type. Most of the 50% of the pediatric hip fractures are the type 2 fractures or transcervical fractures. 75% of them will be displaced. And this is the problem, that AVN is most common in these fractures. It is around 50% incidence. Treatment usually is spica cast, but it should be followed very closely. If there is doubt, if you think that it is slightly displaced, treat it as a displaced fracture, and only spica cast may not be enough. You have to go on following. You give the patient on foot and traction, do abduction, interoduction, and you may get good reduction. If you don't get a good reduction, you may have to do an open reduction. 2 or 3 canulated screws or pins, but if you are following, if the age is to be seen, this patient was slightly older and the pins were fixed. Spica was given for a short period only, and thereafter, because it was a vertical fracture, the pins started bending. So this is a problem. So you need to have, as I was talking initially, that it is a small leg and a dense bone. You have to have a good fixation. So sometimes these pins are, those pins that are threaded pins, are not enough. You may have to do something more. You have to avoid physis, but stability has to be there. So it has to be a first priority. Now, question is whether you should cross the physis or not. A single pin crossing the physis is not bad if it gives you more stability. So sometimes you may have to cross the physis, get a proper stability, and that is the priority. Non-displaced, less complications. Outcome in literature is variable. Highest complication rate of all the fractures because it gives rise to around 50%. Improved with internal fixation or not is doubtful. That if you do internal fixation, they all will improve is not so. So transarticular fixation is controversial as to whether emergency reduction and internal fixation will decrease the probability of AVF. There is not, literature is not sort of discreet about it. There are both types of literatures available. Some say that it is helpful, some say that it is not helpful. But overall, long meta-analysis shows that there is no concrete evidence that immediate fixation will reduce the chances of AVF. Type 3 cervicotrochanteric fractures, they are second most common fractures, 35%, two-thirds will be displaced. Again, the highest rate of AVF, 25 to 30%, as compared to type 2, which was 50%, is 25 to 30%. Cervicotrochanteric fracture, fixed well, will unite, no AVN at the age of, at the end of 8 weeks, but you will have to wait for a year or two to decide whether the AVN develops or not. It will not be seen in the initial access. So non-displaced type 3 fracture can be given again a cast, but you have to again follow very closely for loss of reduction. Best thing is to put a pin and fix it. Displaced, always internal fixation, cannulated screws or pediatric hip screws should be used. This another patient, again, same thing as you see that one of the screw is crossing the physis because that only gives rise to more stability. So results are like similar to type 2. Outcome in literature is variable, non-displaced, less complications. Internal fixation definitely reduces coxavara and non-union in type 3 fractures. It's the patient which is no AVN even after around 3 years. The implant has been removed and this is the result. This is type 4 intertrochanteric fracture. They should be fixed always and should be fixed with proper implant. And they definitely give rise to good results. If not fixed properly, can give rise to problems. So you may have to do either a trochanteric this thing, or as shown in the previous this thing, you may have to add more screw. You may have to add the stainless steel or tension bend wiring. Ultimately, the idea is to have a proper fixation of all the fragments. So it is not common. 10 to 15% of the pediatric have fierce complications. AVN is still possible, but very unusual. So you don't find AVN so commonly in type 4. So type 4 treatment, very young patient, you can give spica and wait and see the results and see that displacement is not there. But pediatric hip screw in older patients or those with unstable reduction is the treatment required. Generally, good results are seen in type 4, very less complications. Very, very high energy can sometimes result in AVN. So you have to be on observation for that. Take-home message is for the fresh fracture neck femur is determine the type and displacement treatment and implant also will be dependent on age. So type of the fracture, displacement, and age. These are the considerations when you try to treat this patient. Urgent deep compression has theoretical advantages and some literature support, but is not proven. So whether you should do early decompression or not, as per my personal feeling, I am not doing it. I have known so many pediatric orthopedic surgeons not doing it, but there are surgeons who believe it and do it. There is no harm in doing that. Non-displaced fractures will have fewer complications and will do better regardless of treatment. The more proximal the fracture, the more likely to get avascular necrosis. Complication rate is very high. Internal fixation is indicated in displaced type 1, all type 2. 3 and 4 if they are displaced or child is older or polytrauma. So undisplaced fracture, you may try close reduction, but otherwise most of the fractures otherwise require a good reduction and fixation.
Regarding,
can I take few minutes on neglected fragmentation if I have got time, or I can stop here?
continue for another 2 minutes or so.
Okay. So I'll just go through the things. Reasons of neglect or delayed presentation is because of the faulty treatment by smoke setter or quacks, as you see here. These are all patients not properly treated or patients not properly diagnosed early. It can be due to inadequate treatment primarily done by the orthopedic surgeon. This is not a proper treatment, and non-anatomical reduction is there. Once the reduction is faulty, it is bound to fail and give rise to problems, and inadequate immobilization. If the screws are not holding well, they also likely to. So inadequate treatment or inadequate understanding of the fracture, inadequate reduction can give rise. Again, another case of a very thin screws and they are not going properly, therefore it has failed. So faulty treatment, inadequate treatment, fractured geometry. If it is a vertical fracture line, Powell's angle is more than 50 degrees, definitely it will likely to fail. So associated with other metabolic disorders, it is likely to fail. Areas, rural and poor belt patients, they get neglected because they don't have facility to get to the proper center. So that is not the fault of the fracture, but that is the fault of our system that we have neglected fractures from there or delayed presentation. Treatment principles should be depending on gap at fracture site, orientation of fracture fragments, avascular necrosis association. You should be knowing that which one is likely to have more avascular necrosis and level of injury. I will skip few slides and go to directly the algorithm. So this was our treatment principle, depending on gap, orientation, avascular necrosis, level of injury. So take home message in a pediatric neglected femur fracture is, you see the gap. If the gap is present, fibular stud graft, osteotomy, something has to be added. If the gap is not present, you can do in situ defixation and do something more. Orientation of fragment, if the Powell angle is more than 50 degrees, then you require a subtrochanteric osteotomy. The change in the angle is required. If it is less than 50 degrees, you need not have the osteotomy. Alignment of fragments, if alignment is present, you can continue with the close reduction and do fixation. But if alignment is not proper, you will have to do anterior open reduction. So this is for fracture neck femur. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for a very informative lecture. So we have a question from Dr. Alpesh Pare. He wants to ask your views on using K-wire versus screw in relation to damage to the physis when you want to cross the physis. So for K-wire versus screws, what are your views on?
See, K-wire will not give a good fixation. K-wire, I do agree that a threaded pin or a threaded screw can give rise to physis problem. But if you put it in a center and only one, the chances of damage to the physis are very few. And even if that damage occurs, it is in the center of the physis which is not going to cause major deformity and growth problem. But I will prefer a good fixation, a stable fixation, than using only K-wires. K-wires in a child of 2, 3, 4 year old could be enough, but not even adolescent and more than 8, 10 year old child.
And sir, as you mentioned, you don't believe in releasing the tamponade defect. Do you even go for hip aspirations to drain out the hematoma in case of?
No, I personally don't, because majority of the time, see what I tell you is, majority of the time in our situation and in our scenario, the patients come either after a day or two. They usually don't come within 3, 4, 5 hours. So whatever damage tamponade has to do, we'll do in first few hours. We don't get patients so frequent. So I have not tried tamponade aspiration.
So one question from my side.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, as compared to K-wires, if you put screws, threaded screws, have you seen more incidence of physial bar developing, which can have a growth arrest in future, as compared to K-wires, the threaded screws?
See, instead of K-wire in a younger patient, you can use threaded pin. Knoll's pin. threaded pins will have a better fixation than simple clay wires.
And less chances of displacement afterwards.
Yes. But one of the pins, if it crosses the physis, because there are incidences, there are cases shown that if you have a subfascial sort of an implant, it can give rise to fascial separation later. So in an older individual, I will try to prefer one of the pins or one of the screws crossing the physis, but at the center of the physis rather than at the periphery.
Right,
sir.
So I think we move on to second talk by Dr. Sandeep Vaidya. It's very challenging in terms of supracondylar fractures, no? Because we always encounter supracondylar fractures where the pulsation is normal and the fingers and hand and everything look pink. But when you come across a widely displaced supracondylar fracture with pink pulseless hand, what is the line of treatment? What is the modality? How do you manage all this? So Dr. Sandeep Vaidya is going to highlight this particular topic. Dr. Sandeep Vaidya, please, welcome.
Yeah, thank you so much. So thank you, Baroda Orthopedic Association and Kirti for having me here. So my brief is to talk about the pink pulseless hand and supracondylar humerus fractures in the next 15 minutes. And before I start, let me just emphasize that I am talking about the pink pulseless hand. Okay, I am not talking about the white pulseless hand, which is a completely different monster altogether, right? So, just to put up a case scenario. So, this is a child around 5 years old presenting with fall on outstretched hand, severely displaced supracondylar humerus fracture, as you can see, large ecchymosis with pucker sign present, absent pulse, and pink fingers, right? So, there are multiple dilemmas that a treating surgeon faces in this situation. What are the indications for vascular intervention? Should you have a vascular surgeon standby? What if the pulse doesn't return after reduction? Would you require to, explore the vessel in that case? What if there is an associated nerve injury? Does my treatment differ? Are there any additional investigations that I need to perform? And what are the red flags I need to watch for, right? That there are multiple controversies in the management of pink pulseless hand can be seen through this, paper, which was published way back in 2010. It was a survey of members of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of North America. And what was seen that even within the members of the POSNA, there was a significant difference of opinion with regards to the management of a pink pulseless hand, right? So with respect to the available evidence and with respect to the what is the rational decision-making, what are the questions that we should ask in order to make an evidence-based decision and evidence-based management in case of pink pulseless hand in supracondylar humerus fractures. So to make things extremely simple, when faced with a pink pulseless hand in supracondylar humerus fractures, there are just four questions that I ask myself. What is the neurological status? What is the quality of reduction after a close reduction? How is the perfusion after reduction? And are there any signs of compartment syndrome? And we will take each of these points one by one and see how they influence my treatment decision-making in case of a pink pulseless hand. So first, let's talk about the neurological status in association with a pink pulseless hand. And this was an extremely important paper which was published in 2009 by Mangat et al. Regarding the pink pulseless hand. And these are two statements out of this paper. 7 patients out of 9 patients in their series with a preoperative anterior introcious nerve or median nerve deficit. By anterior introcious nerve or median nerve deficit, I mean they had a pointing index finger, who were explored. So all these patients who had a pink pulseless hand and a median nerve deficit were explored. And all 7 out of 9 of these were found to have teetering or entrapment of the nerve at the fracture site, which required release. And there was a significant statistical relationship between preoperative median or AN nerve palsy and vascular entrapment or tethering. So authors, they went on to discuss the probable reason for this association of vascular and neurological injury was the anatomical proximity of the median nerve to the brachial artery. Another important point when these two injuries are coexistent, that is the median nerve and the vascular injury, is that detection of compartment syndrome can be difficult because the child does not have any pain. There are loss of sensations. So this is another important point with respect to an AIN policy. And therefore, in the end, these authors conclude that when there is a pink pulseless hand with the median nerve palsy, there should be a low threshold for vascular exploration. Okay, another paper. So this was one, another one published in the same year, 2009. And this, the authors presented 26 patients with pink pulseless hand after reduction and pinning who were referred to their center after an average delay of 3 months. And 23 out of these 26 patients had ischemic contracture, that is a Foucault's ischemic contracture. And in these 23 patients, there were 56 nerve injuries. Okay. And going back into the history of these patients, there was severe pain in the post-operative period, which was suggestive of query compartment syndrome. So the authors went on to discuss the likely correlation between the vascular and neural injury. So as we already seen in the previous paper, brachial artery and median nerve are in close proximity. Also, the radial recurrent and radial collateral artery are in close proximity to the radial nerve, and the ulnar recurrent and ulnar collateral artery are in close proximity to the ulnar nerve. Therefore, these authors went on to conclude that in the presence of a deepening nerve lesion and sensory loss in a pink pulseless hand, it may suggest a nerve anoxia. You should beware of this and you should be ready for early vascular exploration. So we have discussed about the neurological injury part. Next, how does the quality of reduction correlate with a pink pulseless hand? So failure to achieve a close reduction, a satisfactory close reduction, especially one where there is an anterior gap at the fracture site, may be an indication of an entrapped vessel and should be an indication for open reduction and vascular exploration. So this is how a quality of reduction is extremely important in the scenario of a pink pulseless hand. So in practice, how do I combine these two criteria, that is the nerve injury and the quality of reduction? So when faced with a pink pulseless hand with a neurological deficit, like an anterior intraosseous nerve deficit, I give one attempt only at close reduction and K-wire. However, if at the end of the close reduction, there is a gap at the fracture site, then I have a very low threshold to proceed with an open reduction. Also, after reduction, I keep a close watch for worsening of nerve deficit. And if there is a worsening of the nerve deficit, then I wouldn't hesitate to go ahead with an open reduction. Just to give you an example from my practice, this was a child who presented with a grade 3 supracondylar humerus fracture. You can see there was a posterior lateral dislocation displacement. Also, there was an AIN palsy. And at the end of close reduction, you can clearly see that there is a gap at the fracture site, which was not closing. And therefore, we decided to go ahead with an open reduction. And in the open reduction, you can clearly see that there is a neurovascular entrapment over here. So imagine what would have happened if I had persisted with, you know, vigorous attempts at close reduction. So once this, you know, the neurovascular elements were retracted, immediately I got an anatomical reduction. The third point, this is for evaluation of perfusion after close reduction and pinning, right? Remember the term perfusion. This is about perfusion, not pulse, right? So how can you evaluate the perfusion after having performed a close reduction and pinning? So number one is a careful clinical evaluation. And then number two are investigations, which include angiography, Doppler, and pulse oximetry. So what are the clinical signs which tell you about the perfusion? Number one, look at the color of the fingers. Are they pink or are they white? If it is a white, it is a clear-cut indication for exploration. Second point, look for capillary refill. So apply gentle pressure to the fingertips for about 10 seconds and then release the pressure. If the fingers do not become pink again within 3 seconds, that indicates that the perfusion is poor and it indicates an indication, it indicates the need for open exploration of the vessel. And thirdly, look at the muscle activity, that is active movements of the fingers. So this is about clinical evaluation. What are the investigations you can perform? Number one, angiography. So normally in the scenario of a vascular injury, angiography is the investigation of choice. But in the scenario of a pink pulseless hand in supracondylar humerus fracture, angiography has several disadvantages. Number one, it is invasive. Number two, it is time consuming. It is not readily available. And we already know the site of blockage. So there is no additional information that an angiography is going to give you. Therefore, in a pink pulseless hand in supracondral humerus fracture, I wouldn't recommend an angiography. So what are the investigations that can be easily performed? Doppler, it is non-invasive, it is rapid, it is easy, non-palpable pulses may be heard, and waveform should be assessed, which gives you about information about the perfusion of the deeper structures. So a Doppler is a non-invasive investigation which can be easily performed. But in remote areas, even a Doppler may not be available. Or suppose the child comes in the middle of the night, it may not be easy to procure a Doppler in the middle of the night. Therefore, in these circumstances, the simple pulse oximetry is extremely useful. However, in the pulse oximetry, what you have to look at is not just the SpO2. The SpO2 will give you an idea of perfusion of the superficial skin. However, what you are interested in is the perfusion of the deeper muscles. And here, you have to make out perfusion in the deeper muscles, you have to look at the waveform. If the waveform is good, it indicates that your deep perfusion is also good. So don't just rely on the SpO2 in case of pulse oximetry, look at the waveform as well. Right? So perfusion should be primarily assessed clinically. However, Doppler and pulse oximetry may further aid decision-making in doubtful circumstances. Finally, look at signs of evolving compartment syndrome. So in adults, we know the 5 P's, that is pain, pallor, pulselessness, paresthesia, paralysis. However, in children, it is important to look at 3 A's, namely anxiety, agitation, and increasing need for analgesia. Also, as mentioned earlier, deepening nerve palsy, nerve deficit is a very ominous sign and indicates hypoperfusion and need for vascular exploration. Finally, coming to what if none of the red flags that I discussed above are present and you have done a close reduction and pinning, however, the pulse still does not return. What to do in that scenario? So there are various recommendations, and the recommendations vary from immediate exploration to watchful expectancy and exploration after 24 hours. However, the proponents of exploration, they cite the risk of long-term effects, including VIC, claudication, dysesthesia, growth disturbance, cold intolerance, and sensory motor problems to propose exploration as the treatment of choice in case of absence of return of pulse. How would I do approach this situation that I've done a CRKY, the pulse has still not returned? I would still rely on the 4 questions which I asked myself at the start of this presentation. Is there a nerve deficit? How is the perfusion? How is the quality of reduction? And are there signs of compartment syndrome? Just to wind up, you know, what are the steps of open reduction and exploration? So in the presence of a vascular injury, a suspected vascular injury where you want to explore the vessel, the approach should always be anterior. No tourniquet should be applied. No block should be applied. And explore both the artery and nerve. How should the arterial injury be managed? That is primarily the prerogative of vascular surgeon, but broadly the treatment ranges from, you know, bathing the vessel in papaverine to applying a vein graft in case there is a laceration. Some interventional studies have also recommended thrombosis by a transfemoral approach. However, that has a high reocclusion rate. Now, coming to the AAS guidelines that were laid down in 2015, there are 3 points in these guidelines pertaining to the pink pulseless hand. Number one, in the absence of reliable evidence, opinion of the working group is that emergent close reduction of displaced pediatric supracondral humerus fracture be performed in patients with decreased perfusion of the hand, exactly as what we discussed. Point number two, in the absence of reliable evidence, the opinion of the work group is that open exploration of anticubital fossa be performed in patients who have absent wrist pulses and underperfused after reduction and pinning of displaced pediatric supracondral humerus fractures. Again, this is in concurrence with what we just discussed. And finally, we cannot recommend for or against open exploration in patients with perfused hand after reduction of displaced pediatric supracondral humerus fractures. Again, in concurrence with what we discussed. So to conclude, in a pink pulseless hand, first step, go ahead with close reduction K-wire fixation. If there is an AIN palsy associated, low threshold for open reduction should be had. Failure to achieve close reduction may indicate neurovascular entrapment, so beware of that situation. Monitor perfusion after reduction and monitor for deepening nerve deficit and compartment syndrome after reduction. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sandeep. It was a very lucid presentation for a very controversial and confusing topic, especially when we encounter it in a clinical scenario. So I have a question for you. So suppose you have a supracondylar type 3 and it's a pink, a pulseless hand, and you have an anterior introitious nerve palsy or a median nerve palsy. So this is a three-part question. One, does it, it is an indication, absolute indication for an open reduction? If not, and if you go into an OR and attempt a closed reduction, how many attempts will you give before you attempt a open reduction? And third, postoperatively, do you go for any sonography monitoring to see if the nerve is entrapped, or you just wait for the nerve to recover in its probable time, in due course of time?
Okay. So question number one, no, it is not an absolute indication for open reduction. I would give one or at the most two attempts at closed reduction. During my closed reduction, I would assess whether my reduction is springy and whether at the end of the reduction, there is a gap, especially an anterior gap at the fracture site. If either of these is present, I would have an extremely low threshold for open reduction. I would straight away go ahead for open reduction. And the third question that you asked regarding, you know, sonography. So I don't do routinely in my practice. I have not done ever so far. However, as I said, I go by the clinical judgment of my reduction. If there is a gap anteriorly, then as I said, I have a very low threshold for open reduction. So I never come across this situation where I have a doubt whether the nerve is entrapped and I feel the need to, you know, image the nerve. So it is primarily on table that you have to take a call. Do you feel that the nerve is entrapped, or the reduction just came smoothly without any springy feeling and it is an anatomical reduction?
So with the current consensus, we can actually this message to the audience that if they are opening at all, they are not doing anything wrong. So the safer absolutely side is absolutely fine.
I think, you know, we are a bit to blame. I propagated the message that open reduction is taboo. Okay. But I really feel that that is not the case. You know, if your close reduction fails after 2 to 3 attempts, okay, there is absolutely no harm. And open reduction, you know, means just a small mini open over there and just check whether there are any soft tissues entrapped over there. Many times what I do is just take a small 1 or 2 centimeter incision, insert my finger into the fracture gap, just sweep out if there is any entrapped muscle or tissues were there. And at the end of that, I get the reduction very easily. So I don't even call it an open reduction. You may call it a mini incision assisted closed reduction because I'm not exposing the fracture site. So just take a small incision, put in your, you know, fingers, sweep out any soft tissues that may be entrapped in the fracture site. In most of the instances, that is enough. You don't need to then, you know, completely open up, you know, bare the fracture area and bare the fracture fragments and see the vessels and all that, right?
So as expected, we are getting a lot of questions. So another question by Dr. Nikesh Sai is, do we keep vascular surgeon in loop or proceed on our own for exploration?
Well, that's a tricky question. If you are in a setup where it is where a vascular surgeon is easily available within a reasonable amount of time, it is no harm in just giving him a ring and letting him know that you're taking up such a patient, and if need be, he will be called. This is not possible in remote areas, you know, places where, you know, a vascular surgeon may not be available for at least a distance of, you know, a few hundred kilometers. In those instances, I would recommend that you go ahead with an urgent close reduction and K-wire pinning. And in case, you know, any of these red flags appear after that, like, you know, you find that the perfusion is decreasing, the nerve lesion is worsening, or you are possibly getting a compartment syndrome, then immediately don't waste any time in transporting. But you can attempt an immediate close reduction and K-wire pinning even in the absence of vascular surgeon. That is what I feel.
So last question by Dr. Alpesh Parekh, and then we'll move to the next talk. What do you examine, or what are your clinical go-to signs when the patient first comes into the OPD or in an emergency with a type 3 supracondylar and who has an absent radial pulse?
Absent radial pulse. So I think the main thing that you have to look for is the nerve lesion and the compartment. These are the main two things that I look for in the OPD. Now, I agreed that, you know, young child who is howling, it is very difficult to, you know, assess the nerve lesion. But if possible, just maintain a very calm environment and just ask the child to do the OK sign. This OK sign will, you know, tell you about the integrity of all the three nerves. And if the child is unable to do the OK sign, it probably indicates that one of the, you know, nerves is involved. And you know what, while before going in the OT, you have information regarding that. So compartment and nerve lesion, these are the two main things. Additionally, you know, I've seen many surgeons who attempt and close reduction within the casualty. I am not a proponent of that. What I do in the casualty department before taking up the child in the OR is I just apply a slab in just a mild, about 20 to 30 degrees of flexion. I don't try to give the slab in, you know, complete flexion or with an attempted reduction in the casualty or in the OPD. So this is my checklist for the OPD.
Thank you, Sandeep. You provided a lot of clarity on this controversial topic. And now we move on to our next speaker, Dr. Mandar Agashe. He'll be speaking on physial injuries.
Thank you very much to Baroda Orthopedic Association and in person Dr. Kirti Ramnani for inviting us for this symposium. Is my screen visible?
Yes, proceed.
So,
yes,
sir, you... talking on physical injuries, tips, tricks and traps. So basically, physical injury is something which is sometimes becomes quite scary to us. And my main brief for today is how to avoid missing the diagnosis or how to avoid doing a wrong diagnosis. So basically, we should, just like the teacher tells us, we should know the rules of management of physical injuries. It should be like CIDs. And in this team of CID, we should first be able to define and diagnose what are the physical injuries. Just like this guy used to give additional information, we should take some additional information about them. We should classify and plan. And just like Daya, we should be able to treat these physical injuries. So the first rule is we should know the anatomy of these physical injuries, or we should know the anatomy of the physis per se. As we know, there are four zones in the physis: the resting zone, the proliferative zone, the hypertrophic zone, and the zone of provisional calcification. The resting zone is the one which is near the epiphysis or near the joint. It has low oxygen content. It just produces the cartilaginous matrix and has lowest calcium content. So it is near the joint. It's many times not ossified. The proliferative zone is the one which we always have to save. It has highest oxygen tension. It is the zone where the cell turnover takes place, and it is a rapidly growing zone. So any problem in this zone is going to cause issues with long-term growth. The hypertrophic zone and the zone of provisional calcification is near the metaphysis. They are weakest zones, and this is the zone where only cell hypertrophy takes place and it merges with the zone of the metaphysis. We should also remember about the vascular supply. So there are three main vascular supplies of the physis. One is from the epiphyseal artery on the epiphyseal side, the nutrient artery from the metaphyseal side. And what is very important is this perichondrial ring, which is present, which is known as the perichondrial ring of Lacroix, which is important to be preserved. I'm going to briefly mention it later on in my talk. The second is an extension of the first, which is know the anatomy of the physis at that particular age. It is especially important around the elbow. We should always remember this mnemonic, which is CRITO: capitulum, radial head, internal epicondyle, trochlea, olecranon, and the external epicondyle. So this is the way in which these physis ossify at 2, 3, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 years of age. And thus we should know that any X-ray of the elbow should be looked at with the lens of the age. So this fracture at 12 years of age is not the same as this fracture at 4 years of age, because the ossification is completely different. Third rule is always remember to get good additional information. Thus, proper and adequate imaging is important. So always remember two orthogonal rules, like in all, but we should always remember to take oblique views. Oblique views are extremely important, especially in physical injuries, and take opposite side X-rays. This is especially important for the X-ray around the elbow as well as the proximal humerus, and know the ossification centers. So you have this child who was diagnosed as no bony injury, or get given a report that there's no fracture here. If you just get a good oblique view, you know that this is a physial injury or a lateral condyle humerus fracture, and you should be able to treat it well. Additional imaging is very important, especially around the knee, where you should knee and the ankle, where you can do a CT scan, MRI, and arthrograms. So another child who is about an adolescent and has this ankle pain, on the plain X-ray, the fracture is very difficult to see. But on the CT scan, it will show a triplane or a TILO type of injury, which is a Salter 3 injury, which is very important to diagnose. Rule 4 is classify and plan. This is extremely important. There have been many other classifications before 1966. The Poland, the Bergenfeld, the Atkins classification. What is very important is all of us should know this classification, the two great people, Robert Salter and Robert Harris. So this is a thing which was diagnosed in 1963, which is practical, easy to use. It guides rational treatment, has prognostic value, and can be used for almost all fractures. So what is this? A type 1, you can have this classification with a mnemonic of Salter itself. So type 1 is based on S, which is slipped, where the entire epiphysis is slipped across, where the cleavage zone is between the proliferative and the hypertrophic zone, commonly seen in the distal femur, usually has good prognosis. Here, many a time it is amenable to close reduction and plaster, especially at younger age. But at higher age and at specific locations, transphysial smooth K-wires can be used and quite less chance of growth arrest. Second, type 2 is A or above, where there is one segment which goes across between the proliferative and the hypertrophic zone and then across in the metaphysis in the hypertrophic zone. Commonly seen in the distal radius, usually has good prognosis, can be treated with close reduction and a plaster less than 9 years of age. You can, if the Thurston-Holland fragment is big, you can use it for fixation, especially in the distal femur. And there is relatively less chance of growth arrest. Type 3 is lower, that is the fracture line goes below the physis. So here it cuts across the zones of the proliferative and the resting zone. And that is why this has higher chance of growth arrest. Many a times you require additional imaging, a CT, MRI, or an arthrogram. And what is important is that you should fix the epiphysis to epiphysis. And intra-articular reduction is important, like in any intra-articular fracture. Type 4 is through, where it's a through and through injury. It starts off in the joint, goes across the epiphysis, cuts across all layers of the physis, and goes into the metaphysis like this. Commonly seen in the distal femur, has highest chance of growth arrest. Treatment is epiphysis to epiphysis and metaphysis to metaphysis screw. Do not go transphysial with the screw. And last, which is the type 6, is something which is ER, which is end result. What exactly is it? It means that there is a compressive effect across the physis, which leads to growth arrest at a later date. This is most of the times a retrospective diagnosis. So you have an ankle injury, which after some time results in a physial bar formation or physial arrest, which is retrospectively diagnosed as a type 5 injury. Next is you should treat well, knowing factors affecting treatment. That is, there are some non-modifiable factors. Like I said, age, site involved, what is the growth remaining? There are some physis which are very highly growing, like the shoulder and the distal femur. While there are some physis which are very low growing and the Salter-Harris type. But there are some factors which are in our hands. What are they? Which is the timing of reduction, the accuracy of reduction, the gentleness of the reduction, and the fixation. We'll talk about them in brief. So you have this child, an 11-year-old male with a type 2 physial injury. As we discussed, this needs to be reduced. And this was what was done. It is a transphysial screw. Is this okay? So the most important question which everyone asks us, is it safe to pass a K-wire across the physis? And there has been a very good paper from Boston where they put these rules. That is the main thing which they said, that multiple failed attempts and thick wires should not be used. But otherwise, you can pass transphysial wires. But what is very important, you should follow the principles. It has to be a smooth wire. It should be a single attempt. There should not be multiple passes. There are people who do multiple passes, should not do it. What I do is use a T-handle with a low torque and go across the physis and then attach the drill only when I am at the opposite cortex. If you want to pass two wires, see to it that they cross beyond the physis. They should not be too central or too peripheral. The reason is what I discussed about the, the perichondrial ring of Lacroix, which can be damaged if you pass a too peripheral wire. And it should not be a very, very vigorous attempt. So many a times it is not the final X-ray which is important, but the intraoperative attempts which determine the outcome. So in this case, this had a good outcome at about 6 months. We should always be very gentle, never do a forceful repeat reduction. It is important to know that you can pass transphysial wires, but never transphysial screws. Are there any indication for screws? Well, it is only in about type 4 fractures or type 3 fractures where you pass epiphysis to epiphysis and metaphysis to metaphysis. We are going to probably show a case like that. What do we do for late presenters? So this was a child where it was a type 1 injury, but after 4 weeks of plasters, this is what happened. What do we do? Well, it is good to know that especially the distal radius has got excellent healing potential, especially for type 1 and type 2 injuries. What is 1 year post-trauma, and this has been proved by numerous studies. Last, not the least, it is prevent or anticipate bar formation. Bar can occur at the time of injury, reduction, or internal fixation, as I discussed. How do you classify? There are commonly central bars, peripheral bars, which are at the absolute periphery to it, many a times because of the damage to the peripheral ring of Lacroix. And linear bars, which are typically seen in the type 4 injuries, like a line across the physis. We evaluate them especially by the Harris growth arrest lines, which are basically a misnomer because the presence of these lines shows that the growth is taking place well. The MRI with physial mapping is the gold standard for looking at these physial arrests. How do you treat them? Either you can do physial bar excision or treat it in different manners by shoe raises or osteotomies. Just a few principles. You can do a physial bar excision only if there is less than 50%. I think I'll go to only 40% of physial involvement. More than 2 years of growth rate, or preferably a traumatic bar. It should never be a post-irradiation or a post-infective bar. They deal very badly with physial bar excision. The three steps: approach, excision, and interposition. If it's a peripheral bar, it's very easy to approach, but if it's a central bar, you create a big metafascial window, go to the physis. You should be able to, after excision, see this physis completely like this. You can use an arthroscope for that. And to prevent blood flow from oozing into the cavity and reforming a bar, you should have some interposition material, which can be anything, a bone wax, fat, cranioplast, or fibrin. Thus, finally, take home message for this talk. We should know the anatomy, that is, know the layers of the physis. We should know the anatomy at that particular age, especially around the elbow. We should get additional information, that is, perform correct and adequate imaging. We have a very low threshold for getting a CT or an MRI done. We should know about the Salter-Harris classification in detail so as to prognosticate and treat accordingly. We should treat well, knowing all the factors. We should be able to pin, but we should not use a transphysial screw ever. And prevent, anticipate, and treat a bar formation. We should know how to treat them. Thank you very much. Kirti, you are muted.
Thank you, Dr. Agashe. It was a very lucid presentation, and physical injuries, you know, many a times pose you a challenging problem. And if you have a good understanding how to manage and the time of intervention, probably you can avoid major catastrophe and future growth arrest and growth related issues. Now, I would like to ask Alembic people, because they are the sponsors of this program, and at the same time, I would like to have their 30 seconds of presentation. This sort of a small break of 30 seconds in between. Meanwhile, you can have questions to Dr. Agashe.
Yeah, Mandar, so there is a question from Dr. Nikesh Shah. What will you bargain? You will accept a bit of mal reduction or go on for attempting multiple reduction in physial injuries? And how many attempts do you find safe?
Yeah, so it all depends on the type of physial injury. If it's a type 1 and type 2 physial injury, I will probably accept a mal slightly hypo reduction or a less reduction, as against doing a very, very vigorous manipulation in order to get the perfect X-ray on day one. Because I know that the type 1 and type 2 are going to heal up and remodel quite well, especially in case of a fast growing physis. But in case of a type 4 or a type 3 injury, they are also intra-articular injuries. So intra-articular reduction also is important. So many, sometimes we may have to do a manipulation, or we may have to do an open reduction, in which case I'll probably try to attempt a good fixation and good reduction, even if I have to do a slightly more open approach for it. So type 1 and type 2, I will not do a very vigorous reduction, but type 3 and type 4, probably I'll have to do something more.
Right. So another question by Dr. Alpesh Parekh. He wants to ask, how do you counsel the parents regarding a type 4 or a type 5 injury? So very practical and social question.
Absolutely. So to be frank, in all cases of physical injuries, I always am very, very, I'm very clear that anything can happen to the growth. And what we are doing is trying to save the growth as much as possible. So I'm always over prognosticating. I always say that the growth plate is affected seriously, and we are trying to attempt it even in a type 1 and type 2 injury, because if in case we say that everything is going to be hunky-dory in a type 1 and type 2 injury and some growth arrest occurs, then it is going to be an issue. So even for type 1, 2, 3, 4, any sort of growth plate injury, I am going to give a prognostication which is quite grim, and whatever good is going to happen is because of us. So that is what I try to gain credit for the surgery. For a type 5 injury, to be frank, I have never seen a type 5 injury on day 1. It is always a retrospective injury, and then we have to correlate with some form of past trauma some injury later in the past, and then we have to deal with the effect of that physical injury in the present time. So type 5 injury is always a retrospective diagnosis. I don't know about the panel, but I have never ever seen a type 5 injury on day 1.
It's right. That's an retrospective injury. This question comes from Dr. Sejal Shah. So for a type 1 transphysial neck femur, for a Delbet 1, do you suggest passing multiple pins or screw?
Yeah, so a neck femur is probably an exception to the rule. A neck femur requires a good amount of stability, and the consequence of causing a fusion of the neck femur is not very high. So that is why routinely we can use transphysial screws in older age. The same doesn't hold true for a very young age, probably less than say 8 years or so, where it is better to pass multiple K wires rather than screws. The commonest type of neck femur which we see is SCFE, where we routinely use good added screws across the physis. And the issue is never a physial arrest. In fact, we want to create a physial arrest in SCFE. And it all depends on the age and as well as an indication. If it's a acute onset Delbet type 1 injury in a very young child, I'll probably use multiple K wires and immobilize with a spica. While if it's more than 9 years of age, I'll definitely pass in screws.
Right. Dr. Jayesh has a question. What is the role of implant extraction? When will you extract an implant if you have crossed the physis?
So it's going to be a very early implant role. So if I have passed a K-wire, say for a distal radius physis injury, it's not more than 3 to 4 weeks that I remove the wire. At the most, I keep it for about 3 to 4 weeks and I do a very early implant removal. Basically, because it's going to heal up very well. In fact, in a very early implant removal, I can just give a plaster for a couple of more weeks for it to completely heal up.
Thank you, Manda.
Manda, can I have one question, last question?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Please, sir, yeah. Go ahead.
Manda, in type 2 and 3 epiphyseal injuries at the level of at the level of distal end of femur,
yes, sir.
Generally, you come across with any kind of progressive deformity if after the primary healing of physial injury. And there is a long growth potential, let's say minimum 3 to 4 years or 5 years. So in such patients, you can have progressive deformity either in terms of valgus or varus.
Right.
So how do you manage these patients further? After the initial physial injury is managed, and if you see during further follow-up that the child is developing deformity. So how do you manage such patients?
So excellent question, sir. And the distal femur is one thing which usually does not conform to the Salter-Harris types, because it is always important to remember it's a W-shaped physis. So even if it it is an obvious type 1 or a type 2 injury for the distal femur, the prognosis is much more grave as compared to the similar physial injury at the other end. So even if it's a type 1 or a type 2 injury in a distal femur, I'm going to prognosticate in a very grim manner that there is very, very high likelihood that growth plate injuries can occur. So I would like to have some follow-up. In case there is a progressive deformity which happens, then it all depends on whether that physial bar which has happened is resectable or not. Distal femur is in fact a common site for physial bar resection. So if it's less than say 40% or even 30% of the entire area of the physis, and there is more than 2 years of growth left, I will probably attempt a physial bar resection. Along with that, I'll probably put an 8-plate on the other side just to give some strength to my physial bar excision and correct whatever deformity has formed. So especially in a distal femoral injury, I'm going to be extremely cognizant about any sort of physial arrest, either in terms of limb length discrepancy or in terms of angular deformity which can occur. If it is not resectable, I'll probably do a deformity correction at that age and probably put an 8-plate on the other side because I know that this side of the physis is not going to grow. Or I'm going to do a contralateral epiphysiotesis in order to correct the limb length discrepancy.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So now I would like to invite Alembic Pharma, who's the host for this meeting today, to present their product.
Okay, sir, it is already done, sir. We can carry on with the session. Thank you so much, sir, for that.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So now I'll invite Dr. Rajiv Niramane to present his talk on Montagia, how not to miss Montagia, and some bits about how to manage a missed Montagia fracture. Hi, Rajiv, you can start.
Rajiv, sir, you have to unmute. You're on mute. One should I?
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Yes, you are.
First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers and the office bearers of the Orthopedic Association for giving me the opportunity to be part of this academic feast. And also like to thank all the participants who are there on a Sunday, busy Sunday, on this platform as well as through OrthoTV. Basically, my talk will be focused today about how not to miss the Montagias. I had the opportunity to interact and learn from the professor, Dr. Wilkins himself. And like a great teacher, he had handed over this talk to all of us, and I owe this presentation to him. Now let's have a look at this video. A well-set batsman at the end of the day can still get foxed and become talk of criticism. If you have a look at the review of literature, the incidence of missed pediatric Montagia fractures varies to the tune of 16 to 50%, which is a huge number, especially in 2021. So the primary treating orthopedic surgeon has the onus and responsibility to pick it up before it strikes. So let's have a look at the factors which can probably lead into missing a Montagia lesion. Broadly, we can categorize into two, as there can be failure of identification or there can be failure to treat them. Failure of identification can happen with inadequate radiographs, and failure of treatment can happen if the treating orthopedic surgeon is not aware of the mechanism of injury. Sometimes you get WhatsApp opinions about asking, what's this? Is it a coronoid fracture or a high Montagia or a Humes? If you have a look at this X-rays carefully, this looks like a AP X-ray, where the radial head appears anteriorly. This is supposed to be a lateral X-ray, but the radial head appears posteriorly. The same patient, but two different interpretations. Or there can be such X-rays where the we know that there is something happening at the proximal radius ulna, but we are not able to get a clear view because the X-ray has been shot with the distal humerus flat on the radial flat on the cassette, rather than having the proximal radius which is flat on the cassette, and the X-ray beam should be centered on the proximal radius ulna, and I'd ask the surgeon to do that X-ray and send, and now the picture is crystal clear what is exactly happening at the proximal radioulnar level. You can have these X-rays where an AP and a lateral X-ray has been done. Looks like there is a proximal ulna fracture. And if you just orient the X-ray and draw the line, then you know that there is a Montegia lesion. Another common mistake which commonly is done is people just get the X-rays of elbow only, and the value of full length forearm X-rays is you know justified over here. If we don't take those X-rays, then this ulnar bow sign can be missed, and especially if we have a high velocity injury, then such ghastly injuries also can be associated, which are likely to get missed if full length forearm X-rays are not done. Even if we have picked up the Montegia lesion, sometimes we do come across such X-rays of failure of treatment because we have not taken into consideration what is exactly happening there. So how to identify these fractures? We know that the Beddoes classification has been described. Why we classify fractures in a particular pattern? Because we take into consideration the mechanism of injury, the methods of treatment, and the likely complications which can happen. Now let's consider one by one. So this is a type 1 fracture, dislocation Montegia. The incidence is very high, commonest, 59%. Where you see that the radial head has walked out anteriorly, and there is an ulna fracture, which is an oblique pattern and typically of a tension failure. So three stages have been described. Stage one, with a fall on an outstretched hand in extended position, first thing is going to happen is the radial head will be taken out anteriorly by the contracted biceps. Then all the body weight is transferred to the ulna, so which is unable to sustain the body weight, and the ulnar shaft fails in oblique tension pattern, producing this typical apex anterior angulation. So when we are treating these type 1s, we just have to reverse the mechanism. So put the 3-point pressure, correct the ulnar angulation, and hyperflex the elbow to achieve the radiocapital alignment. Now, depending on the soft tissue status, we can simply conserve, if there is not of much swelling, a younger child, you can conserve these particular fractures with a figure of eight cast. And in older children, or if we are worried about the soft tissue conditions, we can fix these ulnar fractures and make sure that immobilization happens and follow them up for further displacements. Sometimes there can be variations. So whether it's a type 1 variation or a congenital dislocation. So clinical examination can give us a clue. Sometimes there can be bilateral involvement, or as you can see over here, the loss of the ulnar bow sign over here. The proximal radius is too much migrated. And clinically, you can see the valgus. Sometimes there is bilateral involvement in a congenital condition. You may get variations of the ulnar fracture, like in this case, where there is a type 1 Montegia and the ulna has failed at the metaphyseal level. And if got neglected, sometimes you get these calcifications in the capsule in neglected conditions. Coming to the type 2, the incidence is rare, 5%. Now let's have a look at the fracture anatomy. What do we have over here is ulna, which has fractured in the flexion pattern, and the radial head, which has walked out posteriorly. So when the child gets a fall on a semi-flexed elbow, the first thing to happen is the ulnar fracture, which happens posteriorly, and then the radial head walks out posteriorly. So when we are treating this, we just have to reverse the mechanism by fully extending the elbow with a bit of traction. The radial head gets reduced, often spontaneously, or we may have to sometimes push it from behind. And the best position for immobilization is in extension. I know this can be a little cumbersome position, but we can increase the, we can incorporate the thumb in the palm to prevent the slippage, and we can do contouring along the condyles to get a proper grip. We can have type 2 equivalence where, along with ulnar fracture and a posterior dislocation, there can be radial neck fractures. The treatment principle remains the same. Coming to the type 3, 26% incidence. Now, how a type 3 is going to happen? With a fall on an outstretched hand and a lateral thrust, there would be a proximal ulnar fracture with a varus force. The radial head will walk out laterally. Sometimes it can geopardize the posterior interosseous nerve to cause neuropraxia. So what are the steps in obtaining the reduction? We have to extend the elbow to lock the olecranon, then correct the varus deformity of the ulna, and by applying a valgus force to the distal forearm. And what about the radial head? Usually it reduces spontaneously with reduction of the ulna. We may have to apply a direct force to the radial head. And as you can see, if not treated, can end up with neglected ones like this, the deformity. The fixation to counter strong forearm flexors is very much essential, particularly in type 3s, which can be done by either intramedullary fixation or a plate fixation, or if we don't have a very high, if the fracture is very high and there is no adequate plates or a space available for putting plate, then we can get a stable fixation even with K-wires. The crux here is we have to have a very, very good fixation, which has to be stable. Sometimes you can have a type 3 equivalent where, along with the ulnar fracture and a lateral radial head, there can be a lateral condyle fracture, which needs to be treated as per routine standard protocol. This is not a simple forearm fracture, but it's the radial head has walked out with a radial shaft fracture and classified as type 4, though rare. But treatment is very simple. We just have to convert this type 4 into type 1 by stabilizing the radius with an intramedullary nail and then further proceed as per management principles of type 1. We can have type 4 equivalence where, instead of the radial shaft, the radial neck has fractured over here. Again, management principles remains the same. So how not to miss the montagia? There is an old saying that your eyes will see what your mind knows. So we just have to remember this mnemonic, and you guess the montagia on day one by having good x-rays. Look for those unique fracture patterns, look for those equivalents, get a stable fixation and reduction, and make sure that you follow them up adequately to avoid any further issues. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajiv. Very lucid presentation. Especially, it's a very complex injury in terms of, you know, going by classifications and variants of montagia fracture dislocation. So initially, you have to feel the pulse of type of injury and then evaluate meticulously, so that initial treatment would be quite gratifying, rather than, you know, correcting the deformity after missing the montagia fracture dislocation. And second problem generally which comes across with montagia fracture dislocation is sometimes, you know, superior radial ulnar synostosis, which develops over a period of time, not immediately. So proper fixation, proper understanding of a fracture is very important. Thank you so much. We can have a few questions related to this particular topic, and then we go over to clinical cases.
So Rajiv, Dr. Dinesh wants to ask, Dr. Dinesh Bulusu, and this was my my follow-up question on that too. So what would you do in an isolated radial head epiphysis dislocation or a fracture where there is a type 1 or type 2 injury? And my question or follow-up question on that was, whenever there is a Montagia with a green stick ulna fracture, where you can just see the bend on the ulna and you take the child to OR, try to reduce the radial head, doesn't come. Do you go ahead, do an osteotomy at the same time or basically create a fracture and then reduce the radial head, or there is any other way you do it, attempt to do it?
Okay. So I'll answer the question number two first. So when we know that there is a ulnar, there is no obvious ulnar fracture, either there can be a plastic deformation, then in that case, I take him to the OR and I first try to correct the plastic deformation and make sure that whether I am getting a reduction which is stable of the radiocapitellar joint. If that is achievable, then just simply immobilize in hyperflexion. If it doesn't come, then I will do the osteotomy at the level of proximal metaphysis and put it into hyperflexion, and whatever gap opens up and assess the stability, and depending on that, either to fix it with a intramedullary implant or just conservative.
The first question was, what do you do with the isolated radial head physeal injuries?
Okay, so when there is isolated radial head physeal injury, again, first is you have a full length forearm X-ray and take a comparison X-ray of the opposite elbow with forearm and analyze about the ulnar bow. If there is a ulnar bow loss, then you have to treat it as I answered in the second question.
Right. Since there are no further questions, we'll start with the case discussion session. And for case discussions, I would like to invite four new members to the panel. Dr. Ashit Mehta, he is a member of Baroda Orthopedic Association. He's a very good and excellent trauma surgeon, a teacher, and a torchbearer of BOA. Dr. Mahesh Patel, he's an excellent trauma surgeon as well as a replacement specialist. Dr. Anil Shah, who has a special interest in pelvic acetabular trauma, and Dr. Ramesh Panchal, who is also an excellent trauma surgeon, along with he has a special interest in pediatric orthopedics too. Good morning, everyone, and I invite you all to the discussion. Please, sir, you can unmute yourself whenever you want to opine, and I would ask the host to allow these four people to be able to unmute themselves. So we'll start with the case discussions. My screen is visible, sir.
Yes, Kirti, proceed.
So this is basically a 10-year-old boy with a right elbow injury. Before we start discussing, anyone wants to opine what kind of a fracture we are looking at? What is this injury? Do you want to take a...
It seems a very, very unusual kind of injury. Probably that olecranon is split in two places. Probably there's a shear kind of fracture of the olecranon, which is extending right up. And there's a big sort of coronoid piece. So it's almost like an adult variant of a olecranon fracture, probably.
Right. So any further, how would you proceed in this case?
So I would like to definitely get additional imaging.
What would you like for a 10-year-old boy, an MRI or a CTU?
I usually prescribe for any elbow injury. I used to do an MRI with CT cuts. So that gives the best of both worlds.
Yeah. So we went ahead with the imaging. So this is the CT images. So basically, this is a coronal injury, but a three-part ulna shear fracture of the proximal ulna, as you had suggested. So now how would you approach it? Which approach will you take, and how would you like to manage this fracture?
It's a difficult kind of injury. I'll probably do a standard olecranon approach. just for from the subcutaneous border of the other. I should be able to get a, if it's a fresh enough case, then I should be able to get a good reduction and probably fix it with Interfrax tool and put a plate.
Dr. Ashit sir and Mahesh sir, any views on this?
In adult cases, usually I go with the anti approach, but I think in this case, it is on the more lateral side. So we can get away with the posterior approach.
Right, sir. Absolutely.
Just one comment here.
Yeah, Sandeep.
Please. So this is the pediatric age group, you know. This is an extremely rare injury for the pediatric age group. I have never seen this kind of injury.
Exactly, Sandeep. Yes, you're right.
And for this reason, you know, just because he's a, you know, pediatric patient, I would not venture to treat this on my own. I would definitely involve an adult trauma surgeon to guide me in this case. In fact, I would invite him to be the primary surgeon and I would assist him to see how he goes about.
I did not do this, but I'll tell you what I did. So I searched the literature and So we searched the literature and there is a report from UK Glasgow where they have reported a similar injury, a rare three-part proximal ulna shear fracture, which required innovative reduction and fixation in pediatric elbow. The almost the same fracture, although the fragment in my case was a little bit smaller one. What they did was they went from the posterior approach and fixed it with screws. So we took a leaf out of their book. We did a posteromedial posterolateral approach and we reduced the fragment and then put the screws in. And this is a 2-month follow-up of this child when he regained full function. So this is how we treated. And this injury was mentioned in the literature. So once I started searching, I got across that report. So because this is such an unusual injury, I just thought it would be good to start with this case. Any thoughts, Sandeep?
Very well done. Very nice. So
you had to very, very nicely done. Almost sort of going anteriorly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very well done.
And as Mandar pointed out, because it was a fixed injury, I was also surprised that the reduction was actually very easy. Yeah. Any points? So, or we move on to the next case.
If the other than posterior approach, is there any other option which probably the faculty or any other senior colleagues can think of?
Actually, initially, before coming across this report, I was actually planning to go anterior. Yeah. But I read this case present, which was reported that I had. I then went posteriorly and fixed it, and it was very easy, sir.
Yes. Only issue. So yes. One. Just a minute.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Can I give comment?
Yes. Sure, sir. Please go ahead.
Only issue is, suppose if you do not get reduction by this approach, by chance, suppose if you do not get perfect reduction, since it is intra-articular issue,
yeah.
So you may face problem of reduction. That is one thing.
Right.
And of course, we have come out with this, probably the pattern of fracture, which requires fixation from front to back rather than back to front. Right. Looking to the size of fragment. Size of fragment is big, so you might need something like fixation from front. So if I'm really worried about good reduction and good stability, I would definitely opt for either anterior or anteromedial, which would definitely give better stability.
Point taken, sir. Because
Did you visualize the articular surface?
No, it is indirect reduction.
It is an indirect reduction, Sandeep. I got the metaphyseal reduction, so I accepted it. And then I did an intra-op arthrogram, which I have not put the slides here.
Okay.
Because I think if there is a soft tissue interposition, and if you are trying through posterior approach, and if you are unable to get it, then you are in a soup. And as Dr. Mandar said, no, that he would like to take help of an adult surgeon and would like to work out which way it should be fixed nicely. So probably going through anterior approach, which is generally a tradition for adult cases. No, generally you have option of having a good, achieving good reduction, at the same time good fixation. Because if the soft tissue interposition is there, then from the posterior approach, probably it would be very difficult to remove the soft tissue and have 100% anatomical reduction.
Right. Point taken, sir.
Yeah, usually you will not get soft tissue interposition in this. It is a pool of brachialis and
MCA. Yeah. These two, two things are going to create problems. Not truly speaking, you will not get to soft tissue interposition in this type of fracture. It is classically type 4 coronoid fracture in adult.
My question to Panchal sir, what would be your preference, enteromedial or anterior?
Looking to this fracture, which is enteromedially displaced, you can definitely deal with
enteromedial. Yeah, thank you.
So we move on to the next case. It's a very interesting injury. This case is courtesy Dr. Mandar. Mandar, will you like to take over the case?
Yes, sir.
Just tell me and I'll move the slides, Mandar.
So this was a 13-year-old boy, had a severe twisting injury. It was quite a big 13-year-old boy, had a severe twisting injury while alighting from a bus and came with a very swollen ankle. Can you go on?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this was the injury. You can see that there is a fracture of the distal end of the tibia and there is a spiral fracture of the fibula. Next. So the question is, how do you describe or classify these injuries? How do you plan? What is the position? What is the approach? And what is the fixation method? So can we have seniors on the faculty, the trauma surgeons? Can we have their inputs here?
Dr. Ashit Mehta, sir.
This looks a triplane injury. Epiphysis is fractured along with the posterior part.
Right, sir. So how will you plan, sir? What is the fixation? How will you go for it?
I think in this fracture, probably the force is external rotation and valgus. So probably that is producing this injury. So stabilizing fibula should be of prime importance and should be focused initially so that at least you have proper alignment and lateral stability.
I'll go posteriorly and reduce the fracture and put it posterior screw.
I would like to do close reduction. And if under IIT it is reduced closely, then I will do percutaneous K wires, multiple K wires in the fibula and the lower end of the fibula and put the plaster. I think they should be able to do it. Or if unstable, because 13 years of age, only mobilize and then we can put the screw from posterior to anterior and to the posterior, whatever the percutaneously, if possible, I can go with the percutaneous method.
Right. So this guy was, though he is 13, he is quite a big boy. So the weight was probably more than my weight. Big guy.
Then I think open reduction is best possible. Close, it won't be possible. So open reduction and fixation.
Right, sir. So what will be your approach for open reduction?
Posterolateral approach, I think we will got the fibula and the lower end of the tibia both in same sitting and we will be able to fix it.
Perfect, sir. Can we go ahead?
Yeah.
Yeah, so as rightly described, this is a type of a triplane injury. So what exactly is a triplane injury? Can we go ahead? So it is something which is known as a 2-3-4 fracture. So it's basically a type 3 injury on the AP view. It's a type 2 injury on the lateral view, but primarily it is a type 4 injury. So it cuts across all layers of the physis, right from the epiphysis through the physis and goes up in the metaphysis. What there are different types, but what in this case it is nothing but a variant of a triplane. So a typical triplane goes across the physis and enters into the joint. Can we go ahead, Kirti?
Yeah. Should I move ahead?
Yeah, please. Yeah. So in this, this is a typical triplane injury. So in which case you can see that the fracture line is cutting across the physis but going down into the articular surface, which in our case was not the case. Can we go ahead? Yeah, you can see that the fracture line was going into the extra articular zone. Next. So this is the typical, while this is our variant. Yeah. But in both the cases, the principle remains the same, which is basically find the big Thurston-Holland fragment. And as Mahesh sir rightly said, that the fragment is usually posterolateral. And that is connected to the distal end of the fibula by the posterior tibiofibular ligament. And usually that Thurston-Holland fragment and the distal end fibula piece is usually one. So what I did was posterolateral approach, which is between the peronea and the flexor hallucis longus. I put in a periosteum, but what is very important to know that when there is a big Thurston-Holland fragment, usually there is a good amount of periosteal interposition at a point which is diagonally opposite. So this anterior periosteal interposition is very important to be removed. Sometimes this is not possible to get close, so you have to do a miss. What I did was a mini open reduction anteriorly, cleared off the periosteum and applied a clamp. Can I go ahead?
Yeah.
Yeah. And the same approach was used for fixation of the fibula. So I put a small plate from the posterior approach of the fibula and passed posterior to anterior interfragmentary screws. Next. Like this. Good. Yeah, so this is the post-op X-ray. Any comments about it?
Perfectly done.
Excellent. Very well done.
So it was a posterior to anterior fixation, PA screws, and posterior plate for the fibula. We'll go ahead. So this is an X-ray at 3 months, and this is probably, I have an X-ray of 3 years post-op. Next. This is at 3 years with full ankle range of motion. This is now almost a skeletally mature guy with full ankle range of motion and no physeal arrest. Thank you.
Thank you, Manda. So now we move on to our next case. Any comments on the previous case, sir?
Yes. Whenever you are thinking of position, especially this type of fracture should be fixed in lateral position.
Right.
Otherwise, you will end up with, and because this is definitely going to give you problem so far as anteromedial periosteal issue.
Right.
The amount of displacement is going to come in the way of reduction. So if you take in prone position, probably you will find more difficult for exploration on medial side. So always try to take in lateral position rather than.
So I did it from lateral position.
Normally, we take in prone position in adult, which is much more easier to reduce this type of fracture.
I would like to do in prone position, sir.
No, still we will, because you will find more difficulty in exploring anteromedial area.
Yeah, that is possibility.
Yeah. So I did it in prone, lateral position, and for the AP view, I just externally rotated so as to get a good.
That is the advantage. Otherwise, you will face a lot of problem, especially a little heavy patient.
Right.
Very valid point.
We have another interesting case of a polytrauma, and I would like to invite Dr. Anil Shah to lead on this case. Sandeep, will you take over the case, please?
That is okay.
Yeah. So Dr. Anil Shah is a pelvic acetabular surgeon with us, and he is
here. Yeah. Perfect. This was a child with polytrauma, and the mode of injury was a road traffic accident. The child was pinion on a two-wheeler, and he fell off the two-wheeler, and the four-wheeler came from behind and ran over the child. And as you can see from this X-ray, it was a pelvic fracture, an unstable variant, unstable pelvic fracture with right hip Delbay type 3 fracture with a dislocation of the right hip. And associated injuries, he had a bladder rupture. He had a hemoglobin of 4 when he landed in the hospital with a blood pressure of around 90/50. Can you go to the next slide?
Yeah.
So this was the CT scan. And so it was the PICU team that immediately took over with stabilization. But our job obviously was now to stabilize this fracture. So there was a bladder injury, and the child was hemodynamically unstable. I would invite expert comments on this. So how would you go about it? Yeah,
Dr. Anil Shah, sir, would you like to comment? Mahesh, sir, would you want to comment on this?
It is posterior fracture dislocation to me. The fracture of the neck of the femur with fracture of the acetabulum. And after the resuscitation and everything is over, we can plan for the fixation of the neck of the femur with acetabulum.
Right. And how would you plan the fixation, sir? How would you fix it?
I think if I'll be able to go with the posterior approach, try to pursue the fixation of the, if I can, I just.
Well, the immediate concern here was, you know, hemodynamic instability and the child.
Yeah, first we have to come out of that. If he is out of hemodynamically everything, then we can plan for the other things.
Right. But the unstable pelvis would also have to be stabilized in order to achieve a hemodynamic stability. So that would be the first priority.
Then we can put the external fixator.
Yep.
On the pelvis.
Considering that he's a six-year-old boy, any special tips regarding putting a fixator in a six-year-old child?
Ramesh sir, want to pitch in with some
very small pin, 3.5 mm pin we can put in the pelvis and we can stabilize the.
And what would be the site of your pin? Site of insertion of the pin.
Site of the supraacetabular
pin, one pin on each side. That will be the best option in this scenario.
Absolutely. So that is where the external fixation of a pediatric pelvis differs from the adult pelvis. In adult pelvis, I think you generally put it in the iliac crest, right?
Yes.
So in the pediatric patient, the iliac crest is so thin, your pins are going to get absolutely no hold over there. So the best site that is recommended in order to put the supraacetabular pin is in a pediatric child is a supraacetabular pin, because here the bone is thicker, you can get a good hold. And so your entry point starts at the anterior inferior iliac spine, exactly at the point of origin of your rectus femoris, straight head, and it is directed towards the apex of the greater sciatic notch. And that would give you a very good hold because the bone is thick and strong in this part of the pelvis. Additionally, his SI joints were completely open. So concurrent with the external fixation, in order to be also planned for an SI joint fixation and plus reduction and fixation of the femur neck fracture in the same setting. The pediatric surgeons, by this time, they had done an exploratory laparotomy and they had repaired the bladder trauma, and there was no other intra-abdominal injury. So the main source of hemorrhage and hemodynamic instability was the presacral plexus, for which we needed to stabilize the pelvis. Can you go to the next slide?
Yeah.
So this is what we did. You know, there are two supraacetabular pins, as you can see, as sir correctly pointed out. So one pin in each side. Maybe the left side pin could have been driven a bit more deeper and towards the greater sciatic notch. But anyway, it served the purpose. And additionally, posteriorly, SI joint fixation was done, and the femur neck was fixed with screws, and the hip dislocation was reduced. Now, here I would like to point out that it was a fracture with a posterior dislocation, which means that the entire, the posterior capsule and the posterior vascularity of the femur neck, we expected it to be, completely disrupted. But when we opened up, we found that, there was some continuity between the femoral shaft or the femoral neck and the femoral head. So probably some retinacular vessels were intact. So all that we had to do is we had to put our digital finger on the posterior aspect of the femur neck and just push it anteriorly, with which the femoral head got reduced, and then it was fairly stable after that. So we were quite lucky with respect to the dislocation. Can we go to the next slide?
Yeah.
So this child, obviously, we expected that, the chances of AVN of the femur neck are going to be very high. The bladder injury, it got healed off, and the SI joints were also okay. We did have some pelvis asymmetry, as you can see over here. But now what we needed to look at was an AVN. So this was a one-month post-op. Go ahead. Next slide.
Just a minute.
This was at 5 months post-op, and this was at 13 months post-op. So this is the last follow-up that we have of this child. Child by now is completely ambulatory, and he's got a very good function. This was before his suprapubic cystostomy was removed, so you can still see the catheter, but that has subsequently been removed. He is now completely continent and passing urine on his own. And at 13 months follow-up, he still doesn't have any AVN, but we still are keeping a close watch, and we are still not ruled out the possibility of there, you know, AVN changes occurring on the follow-up. So we are just still keeping him. So that's the current status. Any comments anybody would like to give over here?
When was the fixator removed?
It was removed at 4 weeks.
4 weeks.
So okay. The purpose was achieving hemodynamic stability, and once the bones became tummy, we were free to remove the fixator.
Very, very nicely managed. Excellent.
Nice.
So the key point over here is the supraacetabular pin gives excellent hold. Otherwise, you know, you put it in the iliac crest, the pins will just walk out within no time. You know, they won't get any, because the crest is extremely thin. In fact.
Right. Right.
Thank you.
Nice case, Sandeep. So we move on to the next case. So this case, I'm very sorry for the X-rays, because this was not primarily managed by IMIT. I managed the sequel. So this was basically a distal femur physeal injury in a 5-year-old young female who met with a vehicular accident, and she had a fractured distal femur. So anyone would like to classify? Mandar, will you want to take a classification?
Okay. It's a Salter Harris type 2.
Yeah.
But the fragment seems have to have gone posteriorly. Unlike the common, distal femur fascial injuries we see, usually what happens is that the distal fragment goes anteriorly. So it's a bit different from that.
Right. Mahesh, sir, how will you manage this injury, sir? Anyone? Ashit, sir, you would like to take on this?
You're muted, sir. You're muted.
I'll try for closed reduction first, which is less likely to be successful here. We'll go for open reduction, reduce the fragment, and put cross K wires from epiphysis to the shaft fragment.
Right. So Sandeep, will you do the same?
But I would like to get an imaging before going in, because I'm not really sure whether in this case there is a buffa component or an intra-articular component. That is ruled out, then what sir said, closed would be my treatment of choice.
Let me move ahead. So this was a Salter Harris 2, and this can be the management options as rightly pointed out. So this was done. So I'm again very, I apologize for the excess, but this was what was available with me. So
pardon me, Kirti, but I would definitely fix this. These cannot go without fixation.
Right. Why have you, Sandeep, changed your stance now looking at this reduction? What do you see here which made you change your decision?
No, see, suprachondylar, distal femur fascial injuries, they are notorious for growth arrest. And growth arrest is directly correlated with the accuracy of your reduction, and this kind of injuries, you cannot really stabilize them in just a cast, an AK cast. They are going to slip. There is a high risk of slippage within the cast. So for this reason, I would definitely, recommend distal femur fascial injuries. They should be fixed. They must be fixed.
So
they are fractures of necessity almost.
Right. So basically distal femur physis is a mammillary physis. And it takes a lot of high energy trauma to basically cause these fractures. So the chances of growth arrest are very high. And this is one of the physis, the normal principles of Salter, the treatment, they don't apply here. So for a Salter Harris type 2 also, we need a better fixation. So how will you fix it, Sandeep?
In this case, I will tell you first, what would have been ideal, if the Thurston-Holland fragment would have been larger, then probably I will just try to, whether if I can annotate, then you could have just put a screw across, from the Thurston-Holland fragment in
like
the metaphysis.
This?
Yes.
Okay.
But here, I don't think that fragment is large enough to take the screw. So in this case, I would just put in cross K-wires, smooth K-wires.
So bearing the fixation, are you happy with the reduction here?
On the lateral, it doesn't look really anatomic.
Right.
There still seems to be posterior displacement of the distal bank.
Right. So then this was a 4-month follow-up of that reduction. So now we see a clear-cut angulated malunion which has occurred. So now what do you expect? And suppose this child comes to you at this period, what will you do? You will watch
I would observe. At this point, I would observe.
So do you expect remodeling to occur or something else to happen?
The sagittal plane remodeling can occur because it is in the plane of motion of the new joint.
It's in the plane of motion. So, yeah, can you just time, elaborate?
At the same time, I would like to look for growth arrest, which is high probability in this type of injury. In which case, the deformity would worsen, the limb-length discrepancy would occur. So I would keep a watch.
Right. So that surgeon also waited for remodeling. And here,
distal tibia as well.
So there was a distal tibia, which again emphasizes that whenever we have an injury, we should always span the joints above and below. So this was probably parents did not know about, but I found just as an incidental over the X-ray. It has healed uneventfully and there is no deformity in the distal tibia right now. So this was 1 year post-reduction. And as expected, as you pointed out, there is a growth arrest. There is a central bar. This was 24 months post-reduction and the child has ended with a limb-length discrepancy of 3 centimeters now. So what we learn here is that displaced fracture in distal femur, they are 4 times more likely to develop growth arrest, although the amount of displacement doesn't correlate with the development of growth arrest. And internal fixation is the preferred method for all displaced fracture of distal femur. And whenever there is a mal reduction in a sagittal or coronal plane, it can persist and it can increase the chances of growth arrest. So how will you manage, Sandeep?
Right. So how old is he now?
He is now 7 years now.
It's a difficult situation. See, he's still got a long way to skeletal maturity. Okay. So his limb-length discrepancy is going to be very significant. Okay. Right. Now, looking at those X-rays, it doesn't look like there is any resectable facial bar. I mean, it is an extensive growth arrest probably, but yet right. I would like to get imaging done to map how much is the size of that, that facial bar.
So that is what we did. So this is the physial mapping. So the bar is basically
so do you mean to say
30 to 35% of the physial part, the main bar. Okay.
And so that's a surprise. Actually, on the X-ray, it looked much more extensive. Yes. I didn't expect to be so localized.
Right. So now,
so in this case, being a 7-year-old, definitely you need to give a chance at chance for growth restoration. Hello.
Yeah. I'm listening.
Yeah. So you would like to give a chance of growth restoration, considering that the child is only 7 years old. So in this case, my first step would be to do a resection of the facial bar and interposition of the fat graft, and then observe the child over a period of time to see whether the growth restoration is succeeding or not. So that would be my first step as of now.
Right. So that is what we did. We went through a lateral window and we resected the bar and placed cement as an spacer. And luckily this time we were successful. The physis started growing and the limb-length discrepancy post 1 year has reduced now 2 centimeters. You can clearly see the cement spacer, it has moved away from the physis. So the point of putting this case was that all distal femur injuries, like Mandar has also pointed out in his talk, they have to be treated differently from the management which we suggest for generally for all the physis injuries.
Kirti, it's extremely good that you could achieve growth restoration in this child.
Yeah,
because
I know.
If growth restoration would have failed, it would have been a big trouble. Multiple surgeries would have been needed. Okay. But now you're probably looking at maybe just one, maybe contralateral, epiphysiotasis close to skeletal maturity, and that will solve the problem.
Yeah. But another point, Sandeep, even if the growth would have failed, I would have still given it an attempt just so that I could move the physis. Then it alters the distal femur shape also, the articular congruity.
Yeah.
So for that only purpose, I would still would have done a distal femur
physiolysis.
Yeah. Super. Very nicely done, Kirti. Never thought that it would be only segmental growth arrest. It looked like complete growth arrest.
Yes, sir. So, but the imaging suggested something else. So
Yeah. Only that's why it was like the shape was because that only central growth had stopped, sideways growth was going on.
Yeah. So we are troubleshooting time. Do we want to move ahead to the next case or should we close the session? Dr. Yes. Dinesh, sir.
Kirti, how many still you have got?
I have a lot of cases, sir.
If with the permission, we can go for one more.
I think we can go for two more cases, sir, and then we'll
two more cases is good enough. I think two we can have more cases. Proceed, interesting.
Sure.
So this case, Vaishnavi sir, will you like to take over the case?
Okay. This is the patient who had injury like this. And next, please. And patient was treated with multiple screw fixation, as you see in this X-ray. And then at gradually, there was a collapse, even though fixation was done, as I was talking in my talk, that sometimes the fixation is not very stable enough. And particularly in type 3, type 4 fractures, it can give rise to a varus collapse. So it went into a varus collapse and there was some backing out of the screws, as you see here. Next, please. At the 9 months, patient had a fall. Now, this is when the patient presents with a fresh fracture here. When this screw has broken, is not torn. And you can see here also that there is a fracture. Now there is a subtrochanteric fracture. So we are left with a situation where we are having subtrochanteric fracture and multiple screw breakage. And original, whether the fracture is unite or not is difficult to see. So there is a fracture line still seen. So that means this fracture has not united. There is a fracture here. There is probably screw breakage of this also. And there is only one intact screw. So there are two screws which are broken. There is fracture line there. There is a fracture here. And this is at the end of 9 months. So what do we do now? Question is, how do we manage?
Great case, sir.
Anyone?
I think so. See, in a situation like this, for the present moment of time, let's forget the subtroch fracture. But if there is a non-union fracture, neck femur, or with or without a cox, or with a coxa vara,
okay.
The treatment of choice in such cases is, fixation with a valgus osteotomy. Okay, so my thinking is, in this particular case, why not treat that subtrochanteric fracture like an osteotomy?
Yes.
And fix that osteotomy in fix that fracture in valgus, the subtrochanteric fracture in valgus, and fix the neck femur with a DHS. So a long DHS would be needed, which would fix that neck femur as well as the the distal the fracture in valgus, something like that. That's my thinking. It's a very difficult.
There are two broken screws, threaded screws inside. With two broken screws inside, do you think you will be able to pass a DHS inside?
Would be challenging, no doubt about it. But
so can we just fix the subtrochanteric fracture in a valgus fashion, leave the neck fracture as it is?
Would it feel? You would like to achieve compression?
Don't do anything to this. But basically, there is a fracture which has not united. That is the basic part. As Sandeep,
are you sure it has not united? Sir, are you sure it has not united? I mean,
yes, Sandeep, you can see the fracture line here if you see clearly.
I've seen.
Okay. Yes,
clear fracture line. Is broken from there only.
Yeah, you can see the fracture line.
Yes, sir, I agree with the only thing which I'll like to comment is that just discreet all physis in this case. Just treat it like an adult.
Forget about the physis.
Physis in this case, the capital femoral as well as the trochanteric are absolutely immaterial. So what is important is treating it like a non-union with a fresh fracture distally.
Yes. So
probably removal of the screw as well as the screw heads by any means. Probably use a long, probably like a disc forceps through the track to remove the screw or something of that sort. use all means to get rid of those broken screw threads and treat the subtrach like an osteotomy and fix it with the DHS with or without additional CCS.
The problem is these are all threaded screws. So right. With the disc forceps, it is not easy to remove.
Yeah.
See, until you unscrew them,
correct, sir.
You will not be able to remove. And that is what the problem we faced.
Right, sir.
Can we use some locking plate and put some screws through that, giving valgus at the subtrach side? Chance of getting screw is higher with the locking plate.
Okay.
So this is probably the...
Next. I'll move to the next slide.
Yeah.
Okay, this is what was done. We tried to remove those screws, but it was just not possible. And he was around 14, 15 year old. So it was not possible that we just give. So we thought that this fracture was converted into a valgus osteotomy. And we wanted to have a good fixation across here and a stable fixation. And so angle blade plate was thought. And because this screw again will give rise to another sort of a fixation. Though those two screws are remaining inside, but it has been fixed into the valgus like this. Ignoring those two screws inside, which we could not remove. Next. So this is immediate post-op. You can see the two screws are remaining. Two head screws are remaining, but this has been grafted on this side. And this is the situation. Next. This is at the end of 6 weeks. You can see the callus forming, the union of the fracture. Next. This is the end of the 2 years. The coxa were treated, the neck femur treated, the subtrochanteric fracture, which was converted into osteotomy, treated, everything has healed, and patient has got almost a normal looking proximal femur. I don't say it is normal, but it is almost functionally normal looking femur. Next, please.
It's excellent results, sir.
Wonderful. Excellent fixation.
Yeah. Any thoughts or we proceed to the next case?
Vaishnavi sir, just one question. If this subtrach fracture would not develop, then and if you were facing a problem of non-union with a broken screw, what would have been the line of treatment? The same? You would have gone for
subtrochanteric subtrochanteric osteotomy and fixation.
Naturally.
That was the... See, God gave us the osteotomy.
Yeah, that's true. So... You already had osteotomy done and then you fixed it.
That was nature helping us.
Right, sir. Good.
This was beautifully done. But I would have just, still attempted to see whether, I can get a DHS screw in. Because then that would have additionally allowed us to have collapse at the neck femur side and compression at the neck femur side. But this has come out excellent. Very nice.
Yeah. True. So we move on to our last case and then we'll ask Dr. Dinesh sir to close the session. Rajiv, will you want to take the case?
Yeah.
This.
So basically this was a 9-year-old boy who was traveling in a bullock cart, had a fall. The bullock cart wheel ran over his arm and he sustained a grade 3 distal humerus fracture. Next slide. So he was treated primarily with a debridement and external fixator. Once the wounds were stabilized, the wounds were healed, the fixator was removed. Next. And he was given immobilization in a cast. That was 4 weeks post-op. Next slide. This was at 8 weeks post-op. The surgeon felt that it is uniting very nicely. So he removed the cast and allowed him to mobilize. Next slide. And he had a repeat fall again and sustained this injury. Next slide. And came up with refracture and radial nerve. And I came into picture at this point of time with a refracture and a radial nerve affection. So what to do now? Any comments?
Rajiv, before we talk about what to do now, I would like opinion of the house, especially the seniors. What will they do initially at this injury?
Okay.
how will they treat? Where was the wound? Do you know? It was anterior or anteromedial?
You can see in the clinical picture, it's an anterolateral wound.
Anterolateral wound. So, Mahesh sir and Ashit sir, would you like to comment?
Sir, I would try to do the thread band. I'd like to buy it plus 10 nail.
You'll pass a 10 nail.
For fixed, yeah. The thread band and pass 10 nails.
And
right. But forgiving and at least would have got a good stability and the complication could have been avoided.
Right. So you don't agree with this fixation which has been
done. No. The wound and I the don't wound know is whether, bad and can wait for some time before doing the 10 nil. By the 10 nil can be kept forgiving.
Yeah. Right. And I don't know whether the passage of pins has resulted in radial nerve or it was a primarily radial nerve injury.
Extremely long. Pins are quite big and long.
Yeah. Right. Any other views, any other opinions regarding fixation? So Ashit sir says he'll fix it with 10s.
Okay. Kirti, can we just go a couple of slides ahead?
Yeah.
No, back. Yeah, okay. Over here. No. Say that next slide.
Next slide. Yeah.
So do you think that this, looking at this 8 weeks post-op X-ray, has the fracture healed?
No,
it has not healed.
The plaster is with the cast on. How can you comment on that?
Okay. Fine. Okay. So what will you do now? Next slide. So there is a refracture and a radial nerve involvement. Any attempts of conserving this or what would be the final plan?
No. Posterior approach, exploring the radial nerve.
Okay.
And going for posterior plating with interflex screw from medial lateral for that vertical split.
Okay, fine. So what was basically...
Rajiv is disconnected.
Yeah, Rajiv is disconnected.
I think Dr. Rajiv is disconnected.
Yeah, so what he did in this case was, as sir told, Ashit sir told, he explored the radial nerve, he refashioned the bone fragments, fixed it with a plate. And he, whatever the extra callus was removed, because the bone was healthy, he put it as a bone graft, kind of a bone graft there. And this is how he achieved the result, along with recovery of the radial nerve. So this was the case. Any views on this?
So nerve was not lacerated.
No, nerve was not lacerated. So this was a nerve. It was engulfed in a lot of fibrosis, but not lacerated.
So child had radial nerve injury to begin with.
Yes, sir. To begin with, not from the trauma, but I think post-operatively. This is what I gathered from when he was presenting.
What's about Asif's suggestion now that instead of going for that external fixator and all, initial good debridement and then 10 nail?
Yeah, that's a good option, sir. We if the wound is clear enough, even I would like to do that. And if I want to use a fixator, since I'm an Elizaro person, I would have provided a definitive fixation rather than just a flimsy fixator.
Because in pediatric age group, not to maintain external fixator or Elizaro is quite a cumbersome. And if there is any alternative method of fixation, probably one should think of first rather than going for external fixator and then subsequently internal stabilization.
So totally would depend upon the injury. Suppose the wound is very contaminated, you wouldn't then like an internal fixation to be put in the child.
Mm-hmm. It also depends on your quality of your debridement and urgent wound cover. You have to cover the wound as early as possible.
Right.
Sorry, I got disconnected in between. Just wanted to bring out one more point. Can we go a couple of slides back?
Yes.
At the 8 weeks injury. 8 weeks X-ray.
Yes.
So basically what had happened was the callus, this medial callus was so strong that it literally shielded this primary fracture from getting into union. That was the issue over here. It was so strong. Next slide. As you can see over here, next slide. I think, as you can see over here, it literally this proximal this main fracture site was shielded away, and that has resulted in a kind of a non-union thing. Next slide. So this just I wanted to show. So this was that callus, looking like it's like a literally doubling of the distal humerus fragment.
Mm-hmm. So
the entire thing was then buttoned down. Yeah.
Right.
Fine, Kirti. Thank you.
Nice case, Rajiv. So I'll stop sharing here, and I'll ask Dr. Dinesh sir to close the session. And I thank all the speakers and all the panelists and our BOI members to make this meeting a successful one. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. In pediatric orthopedics, there has been a sea of change over the years. We've had a wonderful session today. Great to learn from the stalwarts the newer trends in this changing world of pediatric orthopedics. I would like to take this opportunity to convey my thanks to Dr. Ashok Vaishnavi sir, Dr. Sandeep Vaidya, Dr. Mandar, Dr. Rajiv Nirmane for their excellent presentations of all the topics, Dr. Ashok Bhatt and Kirti Ramani for moderating this session so wonderfully with, taking care that we never overstepped anywhere. Dr. Ramesh Panchal, Mahesh Bhai, Anil sir, and Asit sir for taking part in the case discussions which were done at the end, which also put a lot, they were wonderful cases that were presented and excellently managed by the experts. I would also like to thank the Alembic group for hosting the session and Dr. Neeraj Bijlani for helping us putting this on live Ortho TV. Thank you very much and hope you have a nice weekend.
Thank you all.
Recording stopped.